everybody for coming tonight, and sorry if there was a little bit of overwhelming line of people. I hope we seated everybody. Tomorrow we have another screening and another one on the 27th. But please, for now, welcome actor Jeremy Piven, director Alessio Della Valle, and the editor Zach Steinberg. And our moderator for tonight is Silvia Vizio, a member of the Hollywood Foreign Press Association. Thank you so much.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming, and thank you for watching this movie, and thank you, all of you, for being here. And we have about half an hour. I will ask some questions, and then I would like to open to the audience. So if you have some questions, just please raise your hand, and we'll try our best to get some questions in. And I'd like to start with Alessio. Okay. Alessio, my Italian fellow person.
Hello.
Hi, Alessio. Tell us how the idea of this movie came about. I mean, I know it's the obvious question, but there is so much in this movie. There is art, there is the thriller, there is the several acts involved, and there is the jumps back and forth. So how did you construct this screenplay, and where did the idea come from?
Hello and welcome. It is genre bending hybrid. I didn't want to go just for one genre, and it is many things, but on the core it is a reflection on accepting who we are, because we're always told, you know, when you create a character, that they need to have an arc, and at the end they will learn a lesson and they will change. I don't think this is true. I think people never change unless they really want to and put a lot of effort into it. So the journey that I created for these characters is a journey in which, at the end, they don't really change, but what they do is they accept who they are. They accept their true nature. So, for example, you know, they've seen the movie, the character of, all the characters do that. They all try to be something else, but they all accept who they are. So the character of Emil Hirsch, Michael Rubino, he becomes the Scorpio. He embraces who he is. He's the bad guy. John Kaplan, he at the end, he does what he wants to do. And also his character, Vincent, he becomes who he is. He loves who he is. He learns, in order to save his brother, he overcomes and faces his fears, and overcomes his fears, which is vertigo, and he accepts who he is, which is a great stuntman, you know, and much more than this.
In fact, we were talking with Jeremy before about how the character of Vincent, in fact, has an arc and changes, and also brings that touch of humor to the whole story. Tell us how that came about, and how close to the screenplay you first read was that character, or how much did you bring of your own to it?
First of all, thank you guys for coming out on a Monday night. You're very brave. The weather dipped below 65 degrees, and you still made it out. You're the true heroes. I read the script, and it's, you know, what you see is what's in his script, and I'm, you know, my take on it is, and you can tell me I'm totally wrong, but it feels like, because Alessio is an artist and has a background in painting, I feel like these characters, and you're going to hate me for saying this, or love me, I don't know, this is the moment that goes viral, where he loses his mind. No. I think these are maybe different sides of yourself, of who you are in a way. I read into that, and this felt like an authentic, different authentic versions. We all can view ourselves as someone that really knows what we're talking about, and maybe we're a charlatan. You know, and you know, like someone that actually isn't an artist, that does karaoke versions of real art, which is what you're seeing. And my character, I played him as if he did have an arc. So I did nothing the director told me. No, I do think that, you know, my character did have vertigo, and he was taught how to kind of be more present. And he ultimately does that. And No, that was not me jumping. That was a 26-year-old fit Bulgarian stuntman. That was not me. And I actually am afraid of heights, so that was not acting in any way, shape, or form. And I had a great time, and Alessio was kind enough to, the script was great, and yet he allowed me to improvise. You know, I have a background in comedy, and he allowed me to improvise, especially in that opening scene, where I just thought it was just so funny that you open on a guy that just gets fired for being a really bad stuntman, and so I just kind of gave him way too much. And Zach is our brilliant editor and probably looked at many different outtakes of me hamming it up, and I had an incredible time, and I think we should celebrate him because I think he did a brilliant job editing the movie.
Which is, of course, my next question, and you have a story to tell about this movie.
We should let Jeremy answer the question. I'm sorry.
No. Your story about your entering into this movie as
right.
And
well,
changing things around or not.
Alessio and our producer, Martha Capello, called me at the end of the movie. They had they had shot the entire movie and had a first cut of it, and they loved what they had, but they could see that it wasn't quite working as well as they wanted. And at the same time, both of them, especially, and I should say Martha as the producer, was just super excited by the content of the movie and really felt deeply that we could make it a great movie. So I was hired to come in, and I worked closely with Alessio trying to. We did a lot of restructuring. The original script I read was a broken script, I call it, a broken timeline, as you can see from the movie you saw tonight. But the original script wasn't broken exactly where it breaks now. We sometimes found better ways to keep the audience rooted in the story and rooted in the actor's character arcs. I also want to say about Jeremy, it's funny, I would sometimes show the movie to a few people as I was working on just for some feedback. Consistently, everybody loved his character, loved Vinny. And my son asked me once, "Dad, isn't there another scene of Vinny? Can't you put another scene in?" And so out of that, we created two throwing star scenes. So, and as I structured the movie, I realized I used Jeremy as a bit of a spine. I mean, how he falls through the movie, because he is the outsider of that group of three. So anyway, we could talk a lot about that.
The break into the three.
Was
already in the script, but
right,
I did that.
Right. What Alessio had in the script, I can't remember Alessio, you had it broken into sort of days, or you had given them names. You had sections.
Yes, it was three chapters.
Right, three chapters.
One about John, one about Mike.
Right. But that wasn't quite working, and it especially when it worked in the original, in the way it was written originally, it worked for that structure, but we couldn't use that same kind of breaking for the new structure. And one of my favorite pieces, I love all the art in the movie. I love the art world. I grew up in that world myself, and that's one of the things I really responded to, both from Alessio as a person and at the footage of the film. And I don't know if you guys noticed, but when John is walking in the green gallery to talk to Paz Vega, there's that neon sign on the wall. It says art plus life equals chaos, which I just love. So I came up with this idea that part one would be art plus life, and then we look through it backwards on part two, because we're now going to watch the same scenes again, or many of them, through a different perspective. And then the third time we have art plus life collide, and then we light up equals chaos. So that's something Alessio and I proposed that to him, and he loved it right away, so we refined it more and more. We got one of the great title designers in Hollywood, Garson Yu, who really took it up 200%. But it was constantly trying to integrate art and movie making, which is what attracted me to the whole project to begin with.
And in fact, Jeremy and Alessio, for both of you, what is art plus life equal chaos? Or how do you relate to that sentence? And what is art, how much art is in your life?
In my life, it's everywhere, in everything. I there is not a single thing that I do that I don't look at how it's, you know, the composition and the colors and everything. And I think it's in every human being, because I think I said this before, but as I was writing it, I thought all that we have left from all the people that have ever lived before us is the art that they have created. In the widest sense of the meaning of this word, meaning you know, architecture with the buildings, the books, the music, the sculptures, the paintings, that's all that we really have left of anyone who has ever lived before us. So I thought art, it was like sort of like an invisible chain that connects us with the rest of mankind. And art plus life equals chaos, because the movie is also a reflection on the relationship between order and chaos and how we want to get to something in life, and then something else happens, which is an element of chaos. And then we make, you know, we take a different road, and we do different things. So I wrote this concept as in the screenplay. I wrote this sculpture, so I had them build it, because it is the core of the movie, art plus life equals chaos, because art also plays like sort of a chaotic element in the story. Like, for example, in the scene in which John goes to bring the painting to the bad guys to have Sarah back, they want to do the exchange, but there's a street art performance in the streets which prevents this to happen, right? So art plays this role. And then I just wrote this core element as a hidden sculpture in the scene. And he recognized it immediately, and he thought, oh, we should bring it up. You know, we should show it more, because you've hidden one of these, you know, this little gem. So we used it as a title sign for the chapters.
And can you tell me what space art occupies in your life besides cinema and obviously acting? But
yeah, no, I grew up on the stage. My parents were stage actors, so I grew up in a theater family, so we were always involved. And so I feel very pretentious talking about this in front of you guys. But no, I think part of what art is to make sense of the chaos sometimes. You know, I've been doing a lot of stand-up comedy, and a lot of stand-up comedy is trying to make sense of everything that we're going through, you know? And so that's also an element of it as well. And this is one of those movies where every time I see it, I see something different.
Interesting. And why Andy Warhol in particular, and why that iconic image of Andy Warhol?
It's because I was also thinking on what is iconic and what is a myth and what creates an icon. And I really liked the iconic role that the artwork from Andy Warhol plays in our culture, because it's the most famous one of him. And it's an artwork that is created out of another, which is iconic, created out of another icon, who is, you know, Marilyn Monroe. So he created like a double icon. It's an icon based on an icon. So there's a lot of there's a lot of hidden ideas on what is pop culture, what is an icon, what is iconic, what, you know? And so this is why. There's much more than this, but this is why. This is why there's like in the Dead Rockstars, this is why I wrote the Dead Rockstars Diner. This is why there are Dead Rockstars there, because they are pop culture icons, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Are you both the Dark Jeremy fans of Andy Warhol and that iconic image?
I love that Vincent, you know, in a way is kind of like this caveman, everyman, where he looks at this poster and just says, it looks like a 5-year-old did it. You know what I mean? Because everyone has a different take on art, and certainly, you know, someone like Andy Warhol. And that's why that was kind of cool. All the characters represented different kind of aspects of who we are, and so there are people that could relate to that, you know. And then there are people that their job is to tell people what art is and what is valuable. You know, we're living in very strange times. You know, we have cryptocurrency,
mm-hmm.
fake currency, real currency. I don't know what kind of currency it is. You know what I mean? Are we in a pandemic? Do these work? I don't know. Yeah, so it's a whole other conversation.
Actually, you shot in Bulgaria, but you shot during this last crazy 2 years, right?
Before.
It was all done before, finished. So you did all the post-production.
During We did the post-production during the beginning of the pandemic.
And how did that affect?
Managed, you know, like everybody. Worked it out, you know. A lot of digital allows you to have a lot of tools now that you can work remotely. So it's not as nice as working traditionally, but we got it done.
Alicia, this is your first feature movie, although you're coming from many, you know, short movies, school. Certainly, I've been working at the art for a long time. How difficult was to put it together for you, this movie? And how did you manage, actually, to have, I mean, we're surrounded here by the amazing Hollywood important people, I mean, from Zach to Jeremy to your other actors. It's quite a feat. That
he wrote a good script.
So
talent is always attracted to a good script.
Oh. Yeah, I think he summarized it. I just wrote the screenplay and I sent it to all of them. And thank God, I was lucky enough and honored that they responded to the screenplay. They all wanted to do it. So this is really the long story short.
You know, small independent movies don't always get done, even when there is, who knows how many wonderful scripts, right, that are out there. Jeremy, how did this movie, really, this script come to you? Through your agent, or did it just take one read, and you were convinced?
You know, yeah, it's always fascinating how things come to your attention.
Right.
And, it's what people don't realize. It's anytime you make a movie, it's a miracle. You know, it really is. And, you know, once you go through the process, I appreciate anyone that's even attempted it. I was performing stand-up comedy in Israel, and an agent who is has become a friend of ours gave me the script. And you know, you're always a little leery of what, you know. And I read it and I loved it. We had a great conversation, and there I was on the set in Bulgaria. That's how it happens.
What are Alessio your film inspirations? Either as directors or as films, where do you draw your inspiration from?
That's a very complex question. There isn't just one source, obviously. And actually, a lot of ideas came. I did consciously look at a couple of specific films and directors, which is actually Clockwork Orange. And another couple of movies, not the movies that people think I was referring to, but it's actually previous movies. But a lot of scenes and ideas really came just from the world of pure imagination. I did have like small thoughts and ideas, like from maybe some French poems of the 19th century that would trigger something. But I really began with the characters. I started with the characters from the noir, you know, the anti-hero, the antagonist, the good wife, the femme fatale, and the innocent, who ends up sacrificing sometimes his life for the anti-hero.
Yeah.
And which is like the five typical characters from noir. And then I began writing who they are, what they want, what they need, and making sure that what they want and what they need were two different things. And then at some point, and I created a word, created like these sets and in my mind, and I wrote them down, and then I would just close my eyes and I would see them talking to each other. They sort of became alive at a certain point. So it was like really from imagination. Everything came from imagination.
Marco Beltrami is not here with us, but you have amazing music by Marco. Would you like to talk about the music? I don't know who wants to.
Yeah, I mean, let's say we like it both. Am I on? Yeah, I think. On? Yeah. Maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not really.
I don't think it's on.
Here we go.
You take this one.
Yeah, I'll just take this.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, when we got down to the scoring, we kind of were looking for a great composer, Alessio and myself and Martha Capello. Well, I can't speak highly enough because she's the kind of producer who doesn't say no, she just figures out how to get it done. And we all like Margot, seemed a little unattainable for the budget. But Martha showed him the movie, and he liked it a lot, and she made a deal. but the pandemic was kind of in full force. So Marco and I were here. He lives in the Palisades, and I'm in Santa Monica. I was working there, and Alessio joined us regularly via Zoom, and he really related to the movie right away. He and I had a lot of long conversations, and what I like about what he did was he didn't do anything that I've heard him do before, and it doesn't feel like any normal score to me. He basically kind of, we had already put in, I put in a lot of temp music, like the Ave Maria, et cetera, things like that. And he responded to that and kind of ended up using that as a kind of a riff on a lot of ideas. So maybe you should talk a little bit about that, Alessio.
Yeah, well, first of all, I was really happy and honored to work with Marco. I love this work. So when he accepted to do the movie, we were all really thrilled and happy. And I also love, because he really embraced the movie and he really embraced its heart, which is sort of reflection on icons, as I was saying before. And he did the same thing, because he did exactly what Warhol did, because he took a famous classical piece, many famous classical pieces that everyone knows, and turned them into something else. So he did the same sort of reflection on a reflection, you know, an icon out of an icon, or a song out of a song, which is more than a cover. He didn't just do it, he redid it. He transformed it into something else. Sort of like when a painter takes somebody else's painting and paints on it, you know? So, or yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive. I would like to hear from, here we have Hen. Would you like a microphone or can you project?
So, when you were making this film, is Tarantino in your head at all?
Not really. Everyone sees them, but not really.
You got Vincent, you got Michael Madsen,
right?
You got
the
not at all.
Well, to be honest, I was looking because it's, you know, he made movies, obviously incredible movies, in like three chapters. But I was looking at other movies made in three chapters, like Before the Rain.
Yeah,
it's a Macedonian film.
Right.
Golden Lion in Venice, 1984. Incredible. Three chapters and non-linear story in which, you know, the way in which the story is told is not the way in which the events happens in their lives.
Right.
Which is basically the same thing I did and he did. So, you know, he wasn't the only one doing non-linear movies. He's clearly the most famous one.
Yeah.
There's not many people watch Macedonian language movies, but I did and I loved it.
Well, and one other thing that I thought, and I don't know if you thought about it, but it seems that when you talk about people don't change, like in a movie like Pulp Fiction, they have redemption, and you said that people don't change. So was that a conscious thing to say, I want to make sure that there's no redemption or change in people?
It's a good question.
I won't ask another one. Answer. I don't take all the time.
I set out to create a different world, like an alternative reality, a parallel universe. In other words, I wanted this to be believable, but not to be New York, New York. Not a documentary style New York. More sort of like New York on primary colors, because I told everyone we are only going to have red, blue, and yellow in every scene, period. No costumes, no set design, nothing with these colors, unless there is a reason. So there's a little green when something happens. There's a little, what was the question? I got lost with the primary color.
You're saying, were you intentional about not having characters find redemption?
Ah, so when I created, thank you. So when I created this world, I gave it rules. And one of the rules was, no matter how bad the characters are, if they repent, they will live. If they don't repent, they don't live.
Right.
So in this world, people, the morality had these rules, had its own rules. So I created a set of rules for everything in order to create like a different world, which is why some characters die and some characters don't, because some repent and somebody don't. I just like that. It really came from noirs, you know. In classical noirs, there is this big sense of morality, and everyone is everyone is not just one thing. Everyone is double or more than double.
Right.
So I tried to create that for every character, to have every character have different aspects and layers. Yes.
Thank you.
How did you end up shooting in Bulgaria? Now you mentioned Macedonia. Did you have any Balkan fixation? Thinking about
Not at all. That was just I was in the jury of the Young Kids in Venice many years ago when that movie was there. So I saw it and it just blew my mind. And then Bulgaria was production reasons. They have the historic takes place in New York, but they built the biggest exterior sets of New York in Europe. So this is why we went there, because it was the most logical thing to do, being an Italian film. Well, I did a lot of things. I did shorts, I did documentaries, especially art documentaries. I worked in art. I was trained as with a fresco painter. And then I worked in music. I was trained with a fresco painter when I was 17. They were doing a fresco in a church in Florence. So I spent, I don't know, 7 to 10 months on the scaffoldings, like 30, 40 meters high on top of, you know, the ceiling of the church. Actually hammering, you know,
wow.
The sinopia of the Madonna on the ceiling in order to. So after that you had to pass the carbon on the holes that are designed, and after that then you put the cement on it, and then you know, the painter I was assisting, he would paint. So I had a mix of experiences. I also made CDs, I was in music, I did all kinds of artistic work.
Question is in congratulations to your work, great work. My question is, when you finish your script, how long took to get like your budget? When, how you get your budget also?
Do you understand?
Yeah. Well, I guess it's for me. Well,
the question was, once you finish the script, how long did it take to get the budget together and get it going?
It's a process, and it's mostly a producer's job. I was lucky enough to find this producer that I was already working with before on other projects, Marta Capello, who she mentioned, he mentioned. And she was just great. She was an enabler. We would come up with this idea, she would say, okay, let me find a way to do it, you know? So any movie is a collaborative process. It's a work effort. It's a collective effort. It's a lot of people giving everything they can to this. And for this, I thank these two gentlemen next to me, because they really worked hard for this movie.
I mean, how long took, like, after you finished your script, you found your budget?
But it's not, you know, I wouldn't put it, because it's an ongoing process. It's not like there is a day you finish writing and then there is a day you... It's more like, you know, ideas keep coming, and then the budget arrives, and then an actor arrives, and then you do location scout. So I was always doing everything. I was location scouting, but I was, you know, doing a lot of things at the same time. So
I mean, you mean you were writing same time looking for your budget, same time? Or
No.
When you finalize your script, and you said, okay, my script is done, and then I'm looking for budget, when you decide that?
Okay.
Right from the time you first showed up any script to many people, then Martha agreed. When did Martha, how long after you finished the first draft?
Right, okay. Well, here's the thing. I didn't write it on my own. As I was writing, I was sending drafts to Martha. She hired me to write it. So
she was already interested in possibly doing the material.
So I was sending drafts, even 10 pages, to production to get feedbacks. So, yeah.
You know, when you make a movie, I can tell you from years, every situation is unique. There's no template.
No, there's no template. Understand, I'm a writer director as well.
Oh, okay.
So, just my question, I just want to process.
Sure.
How long took when you finish your script and get budget?
Yeah.
Well, we're clearly in front of a success story. I'm afraid our time is up. Maybe a quick one?
Yeah, just a quick one.
short.
You mentioned about Martha was already looking to do a film. Did she give any creative input on the type of film she wanted? Or did you already have, sorry, I messed up. Did you said Martha was already looking to do a film. And she hired you to write it. Did you already have this idea on the table, or did she give you some ideas of what she was wanting to produce?
Yeah, I had an idea, and then what happened is I worked on a draft, and then she sent me to London to work with sort of a writing guru who had been working with me on ideas, and we just went back to the characters, and I was renting this apartment in London, and I just did cards for each character on the wall, so I filled an entire wall with characters and arcs. I spent 6 months, like, I have photos of, like, just, it was like a painting, really, you know, with every character with a different color, and I would send it back to her, and she would give us notes, and so it was a process.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid this doesn't work.
Thank you guys for coming out. Thank you.
Thank you.